Hey there, welcome back to my channel, Act on Mental Health. Today, we're going to be diving into a topic called Relational Frame Theory. Now, if you're learning acceptance and commitment therapy, chances are you're going to come across Relational Frame Theory. And so I thought I'd make a video on this to kind of break it down from a beginner's perspective. Learning to play an instrument is a lot like a journey. It involves guidance from others and showing you how to use your instrument and how to understand music. It also takes lots and lots of practice. At first, you're not very good at it. The instrument's a little clunky, and there's probably a lot of times you want to give up. But I don't know if you ever wondered how being introduced to sheet music, how that transforms your relationship with music and the instrument. Now, as you learn sheet music, you're able to better understand the fluency of music. Well, that's where relational frame theory, or as it's known, RFT, comes into play, particularly in learning the context of acceptance and commitment therapy, or ACT. You become a lot more fluent with it, and you get to understand kind of what these processes are trying to accomplish with psychological flexibility. Before we get into RFT, let's take a quick trip down memory lane into the world of behaviorism, pioneered by the legendary B.F. Skinner. Now, at its core, behaviorism tells us that our actions are shaped by previous actions and their consequences. So, if the outcomes are positive, we're more likely to repeat those actions. And if they're negative, we tend to avoid them. This principle of reinforcement is a fundamental concept in learning, known as operant conditioning. So, why was Skinner's approach insufficient when it came to language? Well, think about how babies seem pre-programmed to learn language effortlessly. They're like language sponges. Our three-year-old daughter, for example, Lena, she recently learned how to track emotions, which is kind of amazing at her age. She'll ask, "Mom, you happy?" Or, "Mom is angry because Bo not listening." It's really cute, but it's really amazing. This explosion of language is called generativity, which behaviorism couldn't account for because operant conditioning bases learning from direct actions and consequences. If that's how we learn, how do we explain emotional tracking of a three-year-old who wasn't taught directly to ask mommy if she's happy or angry? This is where relational frame theory, RFT, steps in, and it has something profound to say about how we acquire language skills. RFT suggests that we learn language by relating objects, concepts, or ideas to each other. We call this process arbitrarily applicable derived relational responding. Sounds complex, right? But stay with me. Arbitrarily simply means by choice or selectively choosing one over the other. Applicable indicates the context we use language, and derived means that we deduce or we work downwards to arrive to a new relationship. Imagine these frames as language tools that we use to connect things different ways. We have frames for same, like this and that. We have frames for different, I am not like you. We have frames for time, now or then. And we have frames for space, here or there. We can even combine these frames, like saying the galaxy is bigger than the sun and the moon. There's nearly a dozen of these relational frames that we can use to derive relations. But here's the kicker. This relating ability becomes like second nature, almost like a superpower, and it never really switches off. This is a terrific ability that allows us to work to solve problems. And if there's a solution, then you want your mind to go to work to build a network of relations to help you solve a problem. We know this works, and maybe that's all that matters to most of us. But if you want to take your learning to the next level, we need to not only ask, does this work, but how does this work? At first, at a very young age, we start with non-arbitrary properties of objects and we relate them, such as an apple is bigger than a grape. But as we get into more advanced arbitrary relations, we begin to find out that things aren't always as they seem, such as a scruffy $5 bill is worth more than a shiny $1 coin. Now, how do we decide what's worth more? Well, an arbitrary relationship has been established with money that gives us the relational frame of more and less. Now, children learning about money often struggle with these more complex arbitrary relational frames because a more simple relational frame would suggest that bigger is more than smaller, such as when you put a nickel and a dime in front of a child and ask, what is worth more? A child is going to struggle with that, and they're going to say the nickel because it's bigger than the dime. Now, in terms of money, a different frame is used that the child comes to learn, that more and less is determined by value, not size. And value is determined arbitrarily by society. Or as I like to say to my children when they ask why, when I give them an instruction, I simply say, because I said so. Or dad arbitrarily decided that this is what you need to do. Now, as adults, you would think we have all this relational frames figured out, right? However, sometimes we get mixed up with facts and opinions. And this is where relational frames get interesting. So a friend may confide with you about a situation at work that has them really frustrated, and they may tell you some things. I've worked at this place for less than a year. Fact, I was written up this morning for being late. Fact, my boss is a terrible manager. Opinion. Now, how do you separate the two? How do you know what's fact and opinion? Well, facts are based on relational frames and can be verified. Opinions may carry the weight of facts without verification, meaning you're not able to know that person's state of mind, their intentions. You're not able to observe and have that reported as a fact. Now, just hearing these two truths and an opinion, this leads us to believe things that aren't necessarily true. And we end up with a distorted view of reality. Now, I don't know about you. I probably wouldn't argue with my friend if they said that my boss is terrible. After all, I haven't experienced the workplace. I don't know what they know. But so I would just simply accept what they say. But I would have a distorted view of reality. Now, what if my friend said, I'm a terrible employee? Now, that's an opinion. But what if they treated it as true, as if it was a fact? Now, I might come back to them and say, hey, listen, buddy, you had a bad day. That doesn't make you a bad employee. Negative thoughts can have a surprisingly strong impact on our behavior. In ACT, they call this buying that thought, and to be careful with how seriously we take thoughts about ourselves and judgments about others when they're opinions, not facts. That superpower of problem solving doesn't turn off, remember? And when your mind convinces you that you are the problem and there's something wrong with you, then you are the problem to be solved. And this leads to all sorts of distorted thinking. Now, there's a lot more that can be said about relational frame theory and the implications it has to mental health. And I hope to be able to get into that in future videos. But what's the takeaway here? Well, this understanding of RFT has direct relevance for your everyday life. If you think about language, that is how we understand things to be true and not true. And we can begin to identify how we're framing the situations and how we can begin to have more flexible thinking and more effective ways to respond to life's challenges. And we can stop ourselves and say, you know, is that fact or is that opinion? And to begin to disentangle ourselves from those traps. And there you have it, a beginner's guide to relational frame theory.